Welcome back to PGL Tavern Tales in Bucharest. With me, Tessin and Raven. We'll have two more matches for today, and in both of those matches we'll have, well, a player that will, unfortunately for him, be kicked out of the tournament. The next one will be between Gara and Hoi, so Tempestorm versus still Na'Vi, I think, till
I think officially,
yes.
Yeah.
Officially,
till
yes.
End of the month, but the team disbanded, and now former Na'Vi, so Xixo, Hoi, and Oskaka will be seeking a new team, I guess, right? It's a good opportunity for them to prove how good are they again, I guess.
Yeah, definitely, and it's such a sort of high stakes tournament in terms of the actual players that are here. As we said, when we've looked at each group, it's like we just don't even know who we could pick to even make it through. The quality of players is so high, so it'd be mm-hmm. really good for mm-hmm. either of these guys to get this win and just stick around in the tournament. Especially because on one hand we have Gara, who's still kind of looking for that sort of big victory that he's not had too recently, and then also Hoi, who's been performing in terms of say HCT points, but whenever he's got to prelims just hasn't quite made yeah. it or anything like that, just had a rough time when it comes to the preliminaries. So both these players got a lot to play for here, and the winner will go on to face Life Coach
AK Wonder. AK Wonder is still waiting for his let's say last opponent, right, to prove also that he will advance to the mm-hmm. second day. But we have the bans here right now. Gara banned Warrior, while Shaman was banned by Hoi. First picks are Warrior and Druid. Not something that we don't see during the day, right? We have like a consensus that usually the first pick is either Warrior, Shaman, or Druid. Those are the first three classes that are coming to mind. And then the second ban is very interesting. We have a Warlock and Shaman, so that's not really that innovative, mm-hmm. right? But a Druid and a Warlock, so both players picked a Hunter for a second pick. And that's quite interesting, right? When you see a Warrior and a Druid as the first pick. What do you guys think?
Yeah, I think that, as we said, the Druid and the Warrior picks first, we've seen quite commonly. Maybe didn't expect Druid to be picked first so often mm-hmm. as it has so far today. But the Hunter pick, not normally too high of a level pick, but I suppose, at least on Hoi's side, I like it because I feel like Hunter always performs pretty well versus Warrior. I believe, did we see Gara's Warrior earlier? I'm not sure, actually.
I don't think we did.
I don't think we did. So depending on what knowledge Hoi may or may not have of Gara's Warrior deck, I don't know. But if it's like a control style, you definitely feel confident with that Hunter pick as like a strong counter at least.
Yeah, for sure. I think Hunter is going to do really good here against the Warrior and Priest as well. So I think Hoi will keep it to he really needs it. Probably going to start Rogue or Druid just to play it safe. Like Hunter can for sure win him this matchup.
And not a Priest. What is happening, right? This format is really awesome when you think about it. So many new, maybe not new archetypes, but you see a lot of diverse metagame when it comes to decks. People are bringing Priest. We have seen AE Oxaron Warrior, which is not maybe exactly the prettiest thing to see when it comes to Yogg, but it's kind of like a control warrior with just more spells, which is also mm-hmm. interesting, right? And the new Rogue from G2 members, and what else did we see?
Well, we've seen a mixture of paladins as well. We've seen slightly different variants on anything, as well mm-hmm. as that aggro paladin again from the G2 guys. So I think we've seen at least every class get played like at least twice in these, throughout the series in terms of picked twice at least.
And Gara has his secret hunter as well.
With Lug and Load.
Yeah, it's kind of cool. We have the Yasharaj Hunter from Gara.
That's true. I will leave you guys to it. Enjoy the Hunter against the Druid. And I'm actually saying that to enjoy it because it's a new deck. So have fun.
Yeah, thank you, Lothar. So it's going to be Gara on his Hunter and Hoi starting off on his Druid. And, we saw Gara's Hunter earlier on in his that Yasharaj deck. We can see all the spells in there already with a start of Double Quick Shot, Power Shot, Cat Trick, and Animal Companion. And, yeah, it's not the best opening hand, I would say, for Gara. I think he would definitely want, you always want the Barnes, right? It's no surprise there. But even these cards, they seem a bit too reactive to go against Druid. I would say you definitely want the more aggressive options when you're against the Druid class.
Yeah, for sure. You want to have something like the fast minions, and it's really interesting to see that Hoi throw away Raven's Idol on turn one. A lot of people are speaking about it. Like, do you want to save it so you can pick more, or would you really hardcore just look for the Wild Growth? Because it's either pass turn or use Raven's Idol turn one or Living Roots. You don't have other options.
Yeah, it's I agree. It's one that's in a lot of contention in terms of what is the correct decision, and even, you know, what even matchup is it correct in. But I feel like having a Raven Idol, if you don't have any other ramp in your opening hand, like, I always feel it's just like a safe turn one, right? You can Raven Idol into either potentially a Wild Growth for turn two, or just something else, you know, and then you can start to plan the rest of your turns going forward based off that Raven Idol. But as you said, Ahoy ended up with one anyway, and this is, again, we're gonna see Hoy have to deal with what Life Coach had to deal with earlier, with like, how do I play around? I think almost every secret is in this deck. I don't think we've seen Misdirect, but I think every other secret is in here.
Yeah, for sure. It's a hard one. Do you play around Bear Trap? Do you try to find the Explosive Trap? Do you play around Cat Trick by not going for Raven's Idol? Mm. Yeah, he's playing around the Bear Trap. I like it.
Yeah, because the problem is, as well, you don't want damage to stack up for no reason. And, you know, just hitting face, great, you do one damage, but then he gets three damage back. And a beast on the board, which, you know, can start to really stack up in terms of extra damage and potential combo effects. So I really like the play there from Hoy. Just play it safe. There's no rush. His hand is very, well, I say very spell heavy. It's just spells. So he does just have to really work out what the secret is and try the best he can to deal with it. He is going to prop the Cat Trick with the Nourish, but he does end up getting there and boosts his mana up, and I think that's what he needs to do in this matchup, just try and really get ahead and not let the Hunter run away with like the chain spells it can do.
Yeah, sure, just ignore all the secrets. If you can use Ancient of War or some big taunts, it doesn't matter if there's a Bear Trap, a Snake Trap, Explosive, if you just wait until you've got the game under control.
Mm-hmm. And we see the Raven Idol get played now, and ooh, a few interesting
Nourish
options. Do you like the Nourish here? Wow, I guess Hoy didn't take too much time. I was thinking about how useful the bite could be. It's just a, you know, easy removal for the animal companions that may turn up. But yeah, you know, Hoy just went straight for the Nourish. Do you agree on that one?
Yeah, I think it's a really hard one, but I've been playing with Hoy a lot, and I know that he really likes the Nourish. He thinks it's one of the best cards. You want the mana, you want card draw. It's just really good, so mm-hmm. I was expecting it.
Yeah, and to be fair, he has all the removal he needs. So then the Nourish is, could well help cycle into, you know, the sort of more impactful cards that aren't quite the removal, you know, maybe the portal, well, just as it came up as well, to try and, you know, sort of sustain versus this quite aggressive opening. And so the power Cat Trick has, especially when you follow it with a Hunter, a Huffer, sorry, played by the Hunter,
yeah.
That can just pressure so early on. And there's another Huffer. Wow, Gaara's definitely been a... learning how to smoke recently.
He's really good at it. And yeah, Hoy just wants the game to last as long as possible. Take defensive. And Gaara is just going for Huffer every time.
Yeah, and even the frustration with Moonglade is sometimes the rolls are insane. There are cards like, oh, this is a lot of six drops. Ken, Sylvanas, High Main, for example, are super powerful. But you heal for six, and then you're guaranteed to take at least four next turn, unless a charge minion. Is there any charge minions for six? Or I guess a taunt minion can come out. Like,
yeah,
the,
that's
Arena
Commander he could go for.
Ah, that's true, yeah. Ooh, oh, Scout. Whoa, that's kind of interesting.
Because what do you do against it?
Yeah, so
you don't want to remove a 2/8 minion, but it can really give problems by just...
Yeah, I guess, to be honest, with Gaara's hand and the way it looks at the moment, he has a very aggressive hand. He could just decide to not try and be fancy, just go for more face damage, and then finish with double quick shot.
Yeah, for sure, I like that. Just wait, make the game last as long as possible. And mm-hmm. This is really tough for Hoy, because which secret is it? Like,
yeah, although, excuse me, I feel like Living Roots on the Huffer could be as safe as you're going to feel, because you've already seen one Cat Trick, right? So, and that's the one that gets like super punished by the Living Roots. You kill Huffer and just give him another 4/2 in stealth. I think that feels okay, but it's what he does with the rest of the mana, I feel.
And I believe you attack face first with your hero power, because if it's Bear Trap, you mm-hmm. can remove the bear with your 4/8 mm-hmm. minion.
Yeah, I think that sequencing actually is the best to try and plan around everything, right? You ignore snakes if you choose to Living Roots, as I don't feel this matchup or the way this game's going specifically, you can try and hold on to Living Roots and Moonfire to Malygos kill him. I think you need to really sort of stem the tide of damage coming out here.
Yeah, he's playing around Freezing Trap by not attacking.
Hmm.
And now the Bear Trap comes.
And now it starts to feel worse. It's like, oh god, another trap. What do I do? So pretty confident that the hero power is going to happen this turn. You always try and whip in the hero powers when you can, when this is your game plan, right? You want to end the game, so you push in as many hero powers as possible, and then try and just edge in that extra damage and finish with... Now he's got double quick shot and Call the Wild. So he has got a lot of damage available to him, but can Hoy make something work with his hand here. It all feels a little bit off.
Yeah, I believe that he's really happy he got the Feral Rage, but he needs some taunt. So are you going for the Gadget Sand, or are you going for Emperor, so you can do a really good Gadget Sand next turn? Like, Hoi need to consider how many rounds do I have? Like, I got a time on for sure.
Yeah, I agree. He's definitely on a pretty brutal clock here. Not that it feels like it, because there's no minions on the board for the Hunter, but that hail power starts chipping away, and you realize that when a Hunter's holding three cards in hand pretty much all game, and has had no real opportunity to burn, you know, no easy removal, like, you know, the Scared Nightmare has been down, but Kill Command doesn't deal with it, so it's probably not, you know, useful there, then it probably does give a sense that there is some burn available. There's Yashiraj. Garrod probably doesn't care too much, because the plan probably doesn't get to turn 10 for him.
I don't believe so, and it can actually be a problem with the quick shards, like, he won't get card draw from them later on. Like, you always want to bounce into Yashiraj and then summon another 10-10 if you're lucky enough. But, yeah. This is looking more and more rough for Garrod. Like, he's being able to play all his cards, but like we said, Hoi is just ignoring the secrets and trying to get as much value as possible.
Yeah, and what this Emperor does as well, it has the dual benefit of for Hoi that, one, it's Emperor, you kind of never want it to live more than one turn. But also, if he leaves both of them up, it means either the fake or not of Freezing Trap means it's negated because it can just happen and the AA will get to attack. So it's going to be pretty rough, as it might mean he has to expand the Power Shot and the Quick Shot this turn just to clear up the Emperor. And then that's suddenly a lot of his resources, and the Druid's actually on 17 health at the moment.
He's
just going to kill the... Yeah, the Scale represents more of an immediate threat in terms of raw damage, at least. But this Gadget Zen is going to be pretty reasonable this turn for Hoi.
Yeah, for sure. I believe the Gadget Zen will do a really good trip. 16 damage. It's getting bigger, but yeah, like we know, there's an explosive trap.
Yeah, but what if he gets a second portal? Like, I don't know if Hoi plays two portals or not, but if he gets a second Moonglade, he can just heal the Nightmare back up.
Ooh.
And then that's going to be very risky. And there's Maligos. What was I saying earlier? It's probably not going to be Maligos and then burn to finish the game, but when you've got Maligos, double Moonfire, and even an Innovate as well,
and
maybe I'm wrong.
But I believe you just take it defensive here. Probably going to go Fendrel into Feral Rage or something. I just want the Feral Rage to not risk anything. Just play it slowly. Like, I believe Hoi got the game under control. Just wait.
Do you need to Fendrel, though? Because if you're going to attack with the Feral Rage, then you may as well have attacked first. I suppose you wanted to see what you were going to draw from Gadget Zen, I guess.
That's for sure, right? You could consider going double Feral Rage defense, so I actually like that much more.
Because, I mean, you've got Maligos double Moonfire for a start. So, does it like how it's weighing up the Fendrel? But I just feel like you would have already attacked, right? Because it just makes Fendrel so much easier to get rid of. So, does it like he's going for the double Feral Rage for a casual 16 armor? Why not?
Yeah, like you said, it was a really good play for Hoi, and yeah, we can see that it's looking really rough for Garrod right now.
Oh, he does still have high main, right? So he'll get a 1-1 high main.
Yeah.
In the I think we saw that from Gar earlier when the Yashiraj pulled high main out after the Barnes. So he does get at least some value onto the board with this Barnes. And this is the benefit of using high main in this deck. There's a lot of versions, or like the main version only runs Yashiraj. But if this happens, then Barnes is just a 3-4, which kind of sucks a lot of the time.
Yeah, I like to have the high main as well. Like, you don't want to go all in on one thing. Now you at least have opportunities. And like, someone high main is always a good 6 drop against control decks. So.
Yeah, and now with Living Roots, this is getting progressively more ridiculous. as there's the Maligos on 8, Living Roots for 1. There's no Innovate because he did use it earlier. And now, trade into the minion there. He doesn't want Gadget Zen to just die from explosive, which is almost certain it is because of the way the Scaled Nightmare was like positioned health-wise by Gaara earlier on. So he did trade, but he did give Gaara 3 snakes, but I suppose that's not really too much to worry about when you're on 31 health.
And he also cancelled his card draw, but yeah, he probably has some reasons for that.
Ooh, so do you Raven Idol to try and get some form of like additional spell, like another Living Roots, another Moonfire?
Yeah, I like Raven Idol. You can actually consider going Fendrel into Idol, even though you don't have that much mana. You can do Wrath as well.
Yeah, why not? At this point, why not?
Oh, I got the timer against him. Did he Wrath the 3-3 or the 1-1? Okay, he got it.
Oh,
on the
nice.
Three-three.
Okay. That just looked a little bit weird for us for a second in terms of how it sequenced on the screen, but he did get the bear off, so not too bad at all. And another reduction, so Fandral 1 mana, Maligos 7, seems fair.
Yeah, sounds fair. Okay, so now I believe it's pretty easy to go for the Call of the Wild.
Yeah,
but how do
this
it
is
do
a pretty high level choice here. Call of the Wild or Freezing Trap Hero Power, I wonder. So Call of the Wild is played, of course. Leok helping those snakes out, giving them some extra damage. Not that they particularly need it. It's going to help clear up the 2-2, I guess.
Probably going to... But how are you going to go for Hoffa? I don't like to trade with Hoffa into the 3-3. I like to trade the 2-2 and go face, yeah. He needs to make some pressure.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Hoy's at this moment in time is effectively on full health. So he needs to start hitting him back down again. Is Gara's very quickly running out of juice here as well. Oh, and there's Yogg as well.
Oh,
okay, what's this? What's happening with the Raven Idol? This could just be game, depending on what's pulled. And none of those options are what you want. Yeah, why not?
Yeah, I like it.
So one Living Roots has been used. So is there any options that would allow Hoy to have additional burn somewhere from Maligos, or is he just on Moonfire Living Roots here? I think that's all he's got left, right? And he's used two Raven Idols now?
Yeah.
So I think he has to work with what he's got, but considering Garu's on 22, you know, he needs to do a bit more damage to really end the game.
I like to just go for Maligos, friend. I'll start clearing the board with all the spells and just build it up. Like, Maligos is really good at removing minions as well. Like, it doesn't need to be your win condition by killing the opponent.
Yeah, it's definitely the right size, right? You know, like, it's a 4-12. There's not a lot the Hunter's going to do to be able to deal with it, unless there's, like, a deadly shot you know, knocking around that he can draw into to finish off Maligos. But even then, there's Arcane Giant in hand, Moonglade Portal, a 1-mana Fandral, and then, worst-case scenario, Yogg as well.
But yeah, Fandral into Limbers. The Limbers is on face, I believe.
Yeah, I think you just take the 7 damage now. I like this, because there's not a lot, you know, he's going to be able to play to, like, Living Roots remove, because he's putting himself in a position where he just wins next turn anyway. Kill Command does not look like it's really going to do enough here.
I actually believe Hoy didn't attack with his face. He used Terror Power, but I didn't think he had time to attack with it.
Happens to the best of us.
Yeah, for sure. It's a rough game. Like, they're playing fast, and there's a lot of opportunities in animation, so... What do you do here?
I mean, nothing feels great, does it?
No, and you don't have any more minions in the deck, I believe. I'm not sure. I don't know, Garrus.
I mean, so all we've seen so far is in any game that we've cast of Garrus is single high main, Yashiraj, and Barnes. So we've not seen any other minions as far as I can recall, at least. There's a chance he could have two high mains, and we've only seen one. But normally in the list, I've only ever seen one high main. Be put in there along with Yashiraj and Barnes as well, but the problem here is, like, it just feels like Kill Command doesn't do enough in terms of trading, at least. So it looks like he's just going to go a bit heavy. Now. But is this just game anyway? So he's relying on there not being... how much damage is on now? So the 3-5 bounces because of the freezing trap. There'll be 12 for Hoy, and he only needs 3 more to end the game.
Yeah, I believe you should just take a defender with Moonglade. I don't like to do something crazy with Yogg here.
Yeah, there's no reason to, right? Especially because you have Moonglade to heal. Like, what extra damage is Gyra realistically going to pull out the bag that's going to, you know, save through the Moonglade heal as well as end the game? And that is going to be it. Pretty crazy one overall. Oh, he didn't even need to use Yogg, which is always a bonus. But yeah, that was kind of cool. Like, the double Fel Rage, I think, was key, just to go all the way back up in health, making himself very defensive. And Gaara struggling to deal with that Emperor was a huge problem.
For sure. Like, if you're playing against a face deck and you force them to trade, it's looking really good, because there's no way Gaara's deck can outvalue Hoy's Druid deck by fighting for board. So yeah, I believe it was really good for Hoy just to get as defensive as possible.
Yeah, and we saw Gaara kind of being led by what he had available to him in his opening hand there, because double quick shot, you don't really want to do removal against a druid deck like that, because it's quick shot doesn't do much against most of the minions. So kind of had to go aggressive, and he did commit to the plan, just wasn't quite enough. But we are going to go into game two of Hoy versus Gaara, and is Hoy 1-0 up with his druid again, of course, and Gaara's warrior being played now, and Infested Tauren This gives a nod towards a Nazoth style warrior.
Yeah, let's. I'm really looking forward to see which kind of warrior it is. Like, we can for sure see it control, because there's a brawl and bash. But I'm looking forward to see if it's Nazoth or.
Yep. Ken, there's another nod to that old god specifically. But we were talking about this matchup earlier, and it feels almost impossible for the druid when you're against the kill everything warrior. You know, the one with, like, Yogg and Elise. And everything else is just removal. Not sure how different it is versus the Nazoth style, but definitely I feel Druid has a rough time versus the general, like, standard control warrior at the moment.
Yeah, for sure. It can be really hard. I was preparing for the tournament with Hoy and Sixo, and I asked Hoy, what is your worst matchup? And he actually told me that he believes control warrior is really, really hard for the Druid deck. So, yeah.
Yeah, they have all of the answers required for each one of your threats to a certain extent. The double execute, double shield slam, is and combined with Brawl's worst case scenario, pretty much can line up perfectly versus all the big threats from the Druid. And we pretty much decided that you kind of need Yogg to do something quite incredible to take this match, unless something goes incredibly wrong for the Warrior.
For sure, you either need to rush them down somehow, again, like, it's really, really hard. Or just counter the Nazoth if he's playing it. Like, we are still not sure.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I mean, we've seen multiple death rattles, which gives, you know, quite a big nod towards it. But, you know, I've not seen Gaara play this deck today. So until we see it, when we see it, we'll believe it. But I'm feeling pretty confident about that call.
Yeah, for sure. I believe so as well. So, and I would like to see it. I don't think we have seen it in the whole tournament yet. Like, we've seen some control warriors, but I would like to see Nazoth.
Yeah, and see, now there's a few options here, but playing Emperor doesn't feel too great because it just immediately dies to what's on board and there's still a token left. Afterwards, it gets a reasonable reduction, but not on, I suppose reducing the Azure Drake and the Wrath is pretty nice, but it doesn't do anything too impactful, I don't think.
No, and
it's
like
kind of a rough turn, actually. What would you even go for here?
Yeah, I think it's really, really hard, because even if you're Azure Drake going into Wrath, like, the 2 damage won't help you, and the 4 damage won't help you. Like,
yeah, it doesn't line up very well, does it?
But could you consider going for Mayakeeper and Wrath, or would you go for the Emperor?
I think Mayakeeper Wrath just lines up better overall.
Yeah.
Because at least then you progress in the board a little bit, whereas Emperor, you know, will just die, and then the Warrior's got 5 mana to do with whatever he wants, and there's still the token left. Whereas I feel like you could get a better Emperor off. Hoy leaving it a little bit late. Looks like he's just going for the Azure Drake.
Yeah.
Which I like. I'm glad he didn't coin Wrath, because like you said, the coin Wrath doesn't really do anything he can't do next turn anyway. And maybe get more value from Wrath if he has either another Azure Drake or the spell power lives somehow, and he can actually just like hit it for 2 and draw.
For sure, I like this play by Hoy. I think it will go. Yeah, it was the right move. And he still has Emperor. Emperor is really good, since we know that he's playing Malygos. The matchup is really hard, but if you're lucky enough to get the combo soon, there's actually a chance you can kill the warrior before he gets the opportunity to armor up.
Yeah, well, that's one way you can do it, right? If you just pressure hard enough. But there's something that a lot of the druid lists struggle with, is that pressure. And, you know, we can see now just easy removal there for Gaara. And these 2 arcane giants, these are 2 of the great minions. I love the cards, but versus warrior, you just feel like whenever you play them, they're just going to get dealt with very easily.
Yeah, for sure. Like, if you play them too early with something else, they will brawl, and if you keep them, they will shield slam for 1 mana and just destroy it straight away. So it's for sure going to be hard.
Yeah, and it's kind of resetting the same turn as last turn here, as there's still the infested tauren on the board and still the fireworks equipped.
So how is he going to do this? Like, do you want to go Emperor? It doesn't feel that good. Or would you, like, coin Innovate Juxta Run? I actually don't think that's the worst play in the world. Like,
The problem is, it's always scary to play Yogg when you have such a large hand, because there's potential for overdraw or even the dreaded Astral Communion, which would just lose you the game on the spot. Like, if you throw all your cards, then it's pretty much game over for Hoy. And it's a difficult matchup as it is, so really tough call. Because you struggled last turn, I don't mind the Emperor this turn, because you've hit more cards. You also now have the Innovate and the second Giant as well, which is going to help at least, you know, be able to play something next turn. But again, it's kind of weird when the Control Warrior, because of this Nazoth style, is putting on threats of his own.
Yeah, for sure. It's a really rough one. Hoy need to somehow force the Warrior to use all the cards and then start to push him down. Like, He only has 4 cards left.
Yeah.
So yep. How's he gonna do this?
It's kind of a part of me kind of agrees with you and says, you know what, you might just have to chuck Yogg out and hope for the best. It really sucks. It does, but it's very difficult to get ahead in this match when he's like so far behind already. The one thing Hoi has going for him, of course, as you mentioned, was Gaara only has 4 cards in hand. So, you know, he's not been able to actually keep the draw mechanic up and be able to keep up with Hoi in terms of card advantage, at least.
And even though if he overdraws by using, like, Hero Power now and double Innovate into Yogg's run, it can actually help him a lot, I believe. Oh, he's going for Giant into Hero Power.
Oh. Okay.
That's good as well. I like it. If he can force the opponent to, like, he doesn't know if there's an execute, we can see there's 2. Mm-hmm. But if he used some removal now, before he gets the armor, there's a chance Hoi can go for Malygos and it can be removed.
Yeah, and, you know, it's maybe something we've ignored a little bit, but Hoi has done actually somehow a very good job of keeping the armor down of Gaara. You know, combination with Gaara not having just a Gaara True Heart at the moment. Don't know if he runs it or not, but we've not seen it. But yeah, he's been able to just keep the armor off, actually, at this moment in time, which this is normally the point in the game where there's enough armor that you play the Arcane Giant, it just gets shield slammed, and it's just gone. So it's very difficult to manage, but Hoi's looking pretty okay so far. Shield block is going to come out from Gaara combined with a slam.
Oh, I believe that's actually what he wanted right now.
It's actually perfect. Helps with even more cycle, procs the execute, and leaves Cairn on. Nice full health there and can continue to be a pest.
And now he's starting to get armor. He's on 5 now. It's getting closer and closer to the shield slam, even though he didn't draw them yet. But let's see. Nourish.
Okay, so you have to nourish, right?
Yeah, for sure.
So you nourish into card draw and just try. I don't know what he's after. Maybe the burn, you know, maybe the moon fires and the living roots for the Malygos even, but this is still very difficult.
For sure, it's a really rough one, this one, and my keeper doesn't feel that good, but you don't really want to innovate into Azure Drake, because it's just going to trade him to a 4-5. So, I believe he will go for my keeper here.
Yeah, it still feels terrible, doesn't it? Like, you turn 10 to challenge Cairn, he's just my keeper. Like, you know, he did cycle as well, so he has options going forward. Revenge, not too impactful at the moment, at least. Does have the ghoul as well, but he's on plenty of health, so the revenge won't proc for 3 damage. Not that he particularly needs it to at this moment in time, as he's feeling pretty safe. I imagine, what do you think, just bash and hit with a weapon?
Yeah, I like
to. Leave Cairn to just keep hitting away, because Cairn's not getting any easier to remove at this point.
But I like to just bash it away and then use the weapon. The other thing you could consider is trade with Cairn and then bash. Or trade with Cairn and use your weapon just to get as much armor as possible, because if you know that you have a lot of armor, you're also forcing the opponent to do something else than playing the big stuff.
That's true, actually.
You know that Hoi has some big cards in the hand, because he's been sitting on the current cards in a long time. Like, only the Azure Dragon and Double Swipe is drawn, but Malygos, Giant, they have been there for a while.
Yeah. Looks like he's going to go for the trade with the weapon. He's going to save Bash. So, one of the reasons you would hold on to Bash is to actually help combine with a Shield Slam to give you like the instant armor plus Hero Power and then Shield Slam to be able to, you know, maybe just give you that extra bit of reach you need to, say, kill an Arcane Giant or maybe even a Malygos. So I don't mind this, actually. It just helps. But it's more of a flexible card later on as it is now.
Yeah, it's making it really, really hard for Hoi to consider what is then Gaara's hand, because Gaara has also been sitting on the Execute and Brawl since the start. And the bash for a while, so it's a rough one. You like, but they're good players. They consider how long time the opponents have been sitting on the cards.
Yeah, both players will no doubt have been tracking cards, you know, how long they've stayed in the hands and such. And again, this just doesn't feel great at all for Hoi.
No,
it feels so awkward. Like, what do you even do? You have the Moonfire for Malygos, but that's it. The Innovate isn't going to help too much in terms of Malygos, because neither Mali or the swipes have been reduced, so it's not going to help in that aspect. So kind of awkward overall.
You could consider Hero Powering it and Moonfire it and then Innovate swipe the second one. Then you would also have removed all the armor. But he's not old, the Justicar.
Yeah, that's it. The double ooh from us there is Justicar's draw. It's like, well, that changes a few things, because I think AK Wonder mentioned earlier that in a lot of the matchups, it's just like, if you can keep Justicar, you should. In like, you know, these kind of late game matchups, because you just gain so much value from it if you can drop it on turn six. Start stacking that armor up very quickly. So,
yeah, for the mirror matchup, you for sure consider Justicar as the best card. Some people think Elise is really good as well. It depends on the version, because Elise is a good card, but you don't want to use it too early, so the opponent just use a hard drop and then shield slam your legendaries, because you can also be unlucky with the legendaries.
And a lot of the time in this matchup overall, and I'm talking like broadly about Control Warrior, as opposed to maybe in the Zoth-specific deck, but the Druid just runs out of damage that he can even do to you. Like, Maligos can put out some insane burst, obviously, but if you can just armor up without any threat of that one turn lethal, then you're going to be feeling pretty good overall.
For sure. But like we could see, Garo was actually not going for the Justicar. It's probably because he wants to turn 10 hero power, Justicar hero power again to get the value. That's 6 armor. It's quite a lot.
Yeah, and also he's actually doing a pretty good job of just beating down Hoi at the moment. There's still a 4-4 and a 3-3 on the board. So that's a reasonable sum of damage every turn for Hoi to try and deal with, as well as keeping the armor low, as well as trying to get some minions to stick on the board himself.
It's also really good to force Hoi to use his early minions like Living Roots and Moonfire on the minions, so he can combo it with Maligos. But there's actually a chance Hoi could consider just slamming Maligos down. But he wants the card draw.
So he's not used the Living Roots yet, right?
No.
So he has 2 Living Roots and 2 Moonfire, and he has the Innovate with Maligos. So he can actually Maligos, Living Roots, Moonfire. But is that is that going to be enough with the Justicar coming out next turn?
It's a really rough one. He's actually going for the Living Roots.
Oh.
Could you consider Innovating Giant? Because, yeah, you could actually have Innovated Wild Growth and then use the card draw and then get the Giants for 0, but I don't think he had the time for it. Yeah, you could see Hoi shaking his head. But yeah, that's the problem, like playing a hard deck like Mali Druid. It takes so much time, there's a lot of animation, a lot of card draw, so it can be rough.
Yeah, and every single draw can like dramatically change your decision making within that turn as well. So yeah, it can be very difficult, but at the moment, there's pretty much just Revenge Execute for this Giant.
Yeah, and it feels really bad, but it's like you're forced to do it unless you want to go greedy and try to get some value from your brawls. Like, you know that you're sitting on double brawl, and he already played against the Druid deck, and he didn't saw any Violet Teacher, so he really doesn't need to save brawl for that.
No, I think as well, though, like, I would just be happy with Revenge Execute. There's another threat gone, but he doesn't have the shield slam, so if the Revenge and Execute comes out now, as well as the Justicar, then Hoi will kind of know that, okay, you've had one card in your hand for ages that you've not used, and never been in a good position to use, so that could well be a brawl. And yeah, it looks like Garrett's actually going to hold on here and not bother with killing off this Giant and just saying that, you know what, I'll take the hit this turn to potentially have a better deal next turn with a brawl.
Oh, and a Raven's Idol with Frandall, like, it's a really good combo, and for sure in a control matchup, because you will want to get as much value as possible.
Yeah, well, we were saying earlier, the issue with the Druid is, a lot of the time there aren't enough threats to cut through all the warrior removal, but when you can Raven Idol get a spell and a minion, then suddenly, well, there's an additional threat to deal with.
And what do we see? Innovate, Starfall, Bite. I like Starfall here, I think, or Bite. Like, what do you want to use the Innovate for? You only have 1 Living Roots back in the deck, and your Maligos is on 9 mana cost. So.
Yeah, and also, I feel that once that Living Roots was used, yes, there's another one, but you remove the idea of going Mali and full burst to end the game. It's sort of going out the window a little bit here, because, you know, he's just had to adjust to what he needs to do now, and Starfall was picked up, and that's going to clear up Justicar Truheart quite easily. Means he can go to face with this Arcane Giant and start to bash down that armor again.
So, Sylvanas, I believe that's a really huge draw from Garra. because it forced the opponent to like remove the whole board or ignore it. And you really don't like to ignore it, because if they follow up with Brawl, either Sivana survive or it will take control of the minion that survives.
Yeah, the problem is like, there's probably a quick thought that went through Gara's mind there of going, do I just die next turn, potentially, if I play Sylvanas and just armor up? Because there's potential for a lot of damage, but he has seen one of the living roots. So you see Hoi there hovering over hovering over the burst cards to be like, let me just add this up to make sure.
Yeah, he's for sure calculating the damage, like, if he got it. But yeah. He got 24 damage, so it's not there yet, but let's see. Like, Living Roots is still good, because you summon 2/1/1s, mm-hmm. and that can work really good against Sylvanas. Even though he know there is a chance he got Gara got Brawl, it can for sure be something else, like in Soph.
Yep.
I think Hoi figured out there's a chance there in Soph, like...
Just ruins his day anyway, if he goes too much into it. Foul Rage is more additional damage and armor as well this turn, so... That's not too bad to try and just... At this point, I feel like the plan for Hoi needs to be do all the damage he can this turn, play Mali, burst next turn, and then play Yogg if he's not dead, and just hope for the best. And it sounds like a terrible plan, but we were discussing it earlier, and genuinely feel like you are reliant on Yogg to just push the deck over the finishing line against Control Warrior.
Yeah, I like the idea for sure. And like you said, Hoi is going for it.
Yeah, I really like this. This is... his only way to win this game, realistically. At least, not going to do too much. We are going to see a brawl now, so either Sylvanas lives, or Sylvanas will steal whatever is left on the board. So, Gara probably hoping for the 8-8 and does get it as well. So, there's a lot more damage available for Gara now. But not too much for crazy follow-up. How much damage is there now? There's not enough, because that Living Roots was used earlier on.
So, do you still go for it, or could you consider going for the Yuxa run? I like to go Malagos.
I think I agree. I think I always like to go Malagos first, in case Astral Communion happens, basically. And you just end the game right there and then. Oh, he's going for Yogg, though.
He's going for it. He can still play the card, so he didn't discard everything.
Well, good start, Yogg. In a rage, not going to do too much except make his day a little bit worse. deadly shot, okay. Wow, I was going to say that giant was going to really turn against its original master there for a split second.
Oh, mind control.
Oh, okay. Any damage to face is huge here.
Oh, he just doesn't want to hit himself.
Banding him? Oh my god, this is insane. Okay, can he gain enough armor to be able to survive here? There's 13 damage available from just Maligos Moonfire Living Roots. There's still a Moonfire in the deck, isn't there? We've not seen any Moonfires played this
No,
this
he,
game.
He still has one Moonfire
yeah, so
left
if
in the deck.
Draws Moonfire. That's just the game.
And Gara can't really do anything.
No, there's no options. Like, Acolyte Revenge, but well, never mind, it's going to get sniped.
The snipe is going to give him a card draw, though.
Yeah. I mean, he was going to revenge anyway. Oh my god, a second revenge. That is not what Gara wanted to see. Do you have the artifact? Oh, so even next turn, he can actually just, like, Gadget Zan Feral Rage for even more damage and cycle into the Moonfire, potentially. Which I actually quite like, because if that was your opponent's turn when you've put them to 10, you're feeling pretty confident.
Yeah, for sure. Like, this is looking really good for Hoi right now. Like, Gara was a hit, like, the whole game, but it's going to change stuff if you get enough value. And, like, the Warrior is getting low, like we said. Mm. That's the only opportunity. You can either rush them down or have a good Yuxa run.
I mean, yeah, is there anything that looks better to you other than Gadget Zan Feral Rage here? Because you cycle additional card, you peel the armor off, so then the hero power puts him to 14. Cycles, so you effectively get two more goes at drawing Moonfire for next turn, which pretty much ends the game, unless there's some insane armor gain from Gara.
Yeah, I like the idea, because like you said,
and plus the Gadget Zan has to be dealt with, right? You can't, you know, Gara can't just leave the 4/4 up either, so it gives Gara something he has to deal with next turn.
Yeah, and you want to remove the armor all the time, and if Gara had anything that would give him a lot of armor, he would already have used it.
Yeah, I like it. What's the draw, though? Hoi leaving it very late, and he's not got time to Raven Idol now. This is kind of interesting play from Hoi. I'm not used to seeing him... I'm not saying he's flustered, but he left that turn very late, and I feel like there weren't many options for him. because he could have Raven Idol this turn, which would have been huge.
Yeah, for sure. Like, he, if he gets a Moonfire from the Raven's mm-hmm. Idol, it would be a problem because he can't do the Malygos and Living Root then because he already used
exactly.
one mana on
exactly.
the Raven's Idol.
So this might delay one more turn, but the Warrior is still only on 14. Oh, is that his last card? Yeah. Oh.
Oh.
Okay. I didn't realize it was his last card, so it doesn't matter as Hoyt takes the game. And that's a pretty good job for him. I did not expect him to take that match. Did we see a single shield slam from Gaara that game? We didn't, right?
We didn't. And yeah, you can see Hoy, he's, even though he won, he's a bit frustrated. Like, yep. I know Hoy, and Hoy is happy about winning, but for him it's all about always do the best place.
Exactly, yeah. And, you know, fair enough, the last card was Moonfire, so it didn't really make too much of a difference, but also you would just want to draw it, right? But I guess it stops the overdraw happening, or the fatigue, sorry, in the following turn. So not too bad overall, but Hoy takes it 2-0 so far with this Druid deck, so gonna be feeling pretty confident about taking one more win.
Yeah, for sure. 2-0 is doing really good, and he's going to play Druid again, and I believe Druid is one of his best decks. Like, Hoy is known to be a really, really good mm-hmm. Druid player. So.
And also, bear in mind that this is Last Hero Standing, just to remind everyone. So Gaara would have naturally picked what he felt was his best deck to beat the Druid, because there's no reason not to, right? You want to get the win and then carry on from there. So he now has his Priest, his Dragon Priest, versus Hoy's Druid, so we'll see how... Do you even know how this matchup goes? I've not really run into it too often, I'll be honest.
I spoke with Gera about it before, like, Priest overall, and he thinks Priest is like a curve deck. Like, you need to follow the curve every time and get board control from the start. If you don't get the board, you will lose. That's what he said. So he will do anything he can to fight for the board, and I believe...
You can see that already. Yeah. The Feral Rage just clearing up the Wimmer straight away. And now, it's one of those awkward turns for Priest where he doesn't have an optimal curve play, so he's just going to drop the Pyro just to have something on the board there. But now, he has a few options here.
But the Pyro is actually going to do really good, because if he coin into Azure Drake, the Pyro can trade the other Azure Drake.
It's actually worked out pretty well.
And yeah, Garrus, yeah, know the play straight away, of course. Would you consider Harrison Jones for the pressure?
Yeah, why not?
Yeah, you really don't need card draw.
Yeah, and it can not at the moment.
Good to have the synergy. Like, if he draw another dragon now, he could also consider using that. Just so... Yeah, I like this play for sure.
Yeah, you don't particularly need the cycle at the moment, as you have a lot of options coming up in the following turns. And also, like you said, if he needs to use Bookworm, then he needs his Azure Drake in hand to proc the effect. So I don't mind holding on to the dragon here. Harrison not going to get too much value in terms of its battle cry or any value at all versus Druid. So why not put it down there? It represents a tiny bit more damage, no spell power, but again, the dragon is worth probably more in hand at the moment.
Yeah, I like the play for sure from Gera. But how is Hoy going to respond to it? Yeah,
Is this just Maya Keeper, or do you think Maya Keeper is going to innovate out Swipe here?
I like Maya Keeper for sure, alone.
I'd just be worried about all the removal. I mean, we can see, of course, with our caster vision, that there is just Shadow Word Pain in hand to remove the Maya Keeper if it's played as ramp. And there's not too much you're particularly ramping into unless you're really going to go in on gadgets and the following turn.
But yeah, I think of the ramp played cousins. Well, is he? Yeah, okay, he's going for the hero power. Yeah.
Okay.
Also, I'm not. Oh, he's going for the minion.
Yeah, he's forcing a heal, right? He's forcing either removal of the 3-3 or a heal onto Harrison for the trade.
I actually think that was really important, because that does so Gera can just go for Azure Drake and full face. So I believe that was a really good play.
Yeah, and this is kind of scary now, when the Priest has already got minion on the board, so he's got the board control, and then has two entombs. So and anything Hoy plays, if Gera chooses to, he can just steal it and put it in his deck.
And I believe this is what Geralt tries to do with this deck. Like, I want the ball control, I want to do pressure every turn, and then he can remove whatever comes out. Like, he got four removals on the hand, because the Bookworm can remove a minion as well, with free damage.
Yeah, one of the best ones is Fandral. Just insta-kill Fandral with a Bookworm, which is pretty sick. I feel like now, we almost have to see Gadget Zen, right? Like, anything else... I mean, there's Swipe, Living Roots, but then what are you even doing with your turn? you know, just to kill the Harrison.
Yeah, I for sure like the Gadgets and Innovate as well.
You just need to do something. Like, even, you know, you turn my altar based on what you're drawing from Gadget Zen, but you definitely need to put a minion on the board and start battling back here, because Hoi's actually under health pressure as well. Like, the priest is actually doing a good job of doing the beatdown here.
Yeah, that's the thing. The priest is actually killing him.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Priest can kill stuff.
Okay, so it's going to be a swipe, which means that, yet again, the Harrison will need to be healed for a significant amount if Garra wants to defend it and keep it alive versus the trade. But we can see in Tomb, easiest in Tomb ever, especially because you have the second one. So you just throw Gadget Zen back into your deck, or throw it into your deck, should I say, and you know whatever comes out this turn, minion-based at least, you can choose to entomb it or trade into it with the Harrison. So Garra probably feeling pretty confident so far.
Yeah, for sure. I believe that Garra is playing this matchup totally right by just making the pressure all the time, forcing Hoi to do stuff. Like, Hoi's hand is actually all right to handle this situation. Like, he got a lot of removal, and for sure, he has to run now.
Yeah, and even the Wrath, because it would have felt... It always feels bad to have Malygos in hand and feel forced into a Living Roots on a minion. So having the Wraths now and just choosing to cycle straight through with both of them, why not? And suddenly, Hoi's hand is actually pretty big, and he has a lot of options coming to him now.
Yeah, and Hoi will probably just try to remove as much as possible and just wait, like... Priest doesn't have any kind of burst. I don't believe Garra is running Mind Blast. I don't know, though, but...
you know what? I was going to say that would be a surprise, but from Garra, no. Like, I expect such things from Garra. Like, crazy tech cards, but we see a lot of beefy dragon minions, but what Garra's hand does now is only really allow him to play one minion a turn a lot of the time because they're such high-cost cards, and maybe Hoi can actually cash in on that and get some pretty big tempo plays himself, especially with the Arcane Giant only at 3 mana now.
Yeah, 3 mana, 8/8. Like,
and he has Fel Rage to kill off the 4/4 as well.
And that just makes the Giant even lower. Like, there's a chance he can figure some way out to get so much board control, Garra can't get it back. Like, he needs to use Shadowward Death on Tomb on the Giant if it comes out, but what can he follow up with?
Like, yeah, exactly.
He has a Blackwing Corruptor, that can for sure do something. But, yeah. I think it's looking better and better for Hoi right now. But let's see. I like the Giant Hero power here. Or is he gonna Feral Rage? Yeah, you can actually Feral Rage for armor. And
yeah, and still play the Giant.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, excuse me. I think this is fine because it's not like on 29 health, the 4 damage to the priest face is gonna change much. There's only Living Roots in hand at the moment to combine with Malygos for the burst potential. So there's no Moonfires, nothing else really available at the moment. So I like that play. Just armor up, try and sort of reduce the chance of being pushed so low health that you have to make very defensive plays every turn.
Yeah, and I think Garra needs to do the Shadowward Death here, because he needs to entomb the Malygos. Like, that's the only way he can remove it. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we see the Shadowward Death comes out, of course.
I bet Hoi wishes he had a bookworm now.
So yeah.
Killing off that 3/7 would be awfully nice.
For sure.
Oh, here we go. Looks like Yogg can be the play for Hoi. Everything else feels a bit too slow. He could Nourish into Maya Keeper just to build a bit of a board and try and cycle into these burst cards. But as we mentioned before, that you know, Garra's on 29. Like, you can't burst him down from that health. So he needs to do something to battle for this board and really start to pressure the priest.
But yeah, it's a hard one. Like, do you fight more for the board? Like, you could also just Moonglade Portal and then Maya Keeper, because you will get
That's
a 6
true.
Drop. But he's going for the Nourish.
Okay, so seeing Hoi really enjoy Nourishing for more card draw. Oh, okay.
Oh,
with the Emperor.
Yeah, I like it.
This looks pretty reasonable. Doesn't have to play the Emperor this turn. I don't mind the cycle, especially if he draws some more burn. Ooh, Raven Idol as well. Okay.
That's good as well.
Yeah. Because the combination of Emperor that'll hit Malygos, Living Roots, and you have an Innovate means that you can do some really funky stuff with Malygos and really end up doing a hell of a lot of damage. It's going to be a pretty easy clear up of the Azure Drake for Garra. Heal onto the Blackwing Technician just because keep it buffed up a little bit. And 2 Raven Idols now.
2 Raven Idols, yeah. Hoi can for sure use a lot of spells. Like, the Yogg's run will get really big if he's keeping it on the hand now. And
there's even opportunity to Raven Idol, depending on what comes out in form of potential burn. He could then just choose to Innovate out Yogg. and just say, look, hopefully Yogg clears the board, leave something on my end, and then we go from there.
But he could also get some old.
Hoyle pick Nourish.
Always. I love that card for sure. Do you just go Emperor here? Like, or would you go for the portal? Like, the thing about the portal is you can be unlucky.
Oh, Tessin, do we go Innovate Yogg? That's my question.
We for sure go Innovate Yogg.
Emperor feels like it's just going to gain so much value. It's very difficult to ignore playing it this turn. And, you know, Yogg jokes aside, I do agree with the Emperor play if you go, well, I agree with it regardless of whether he goes for it or not. Just because look at the value. You've got so many cards in hand, and you're hitting key cards like Maligos and Living Roots, which open up, like, infinite more possibilities going forward.
And, like, yeah, and even if Gera somehow consider just trying to rush him down now, you actually got two Moonglade Portal for 5 mana.
Yeah, you can play them both and still get a 6 drop.
The Holy Smite, that's for sure not what he's looking for right now. But he could... I like the Bugworm here. Like, you can remove a 3 mana minion. A 3 damage minion, of course. But it's a rough one.
Yeah. I mean, the Bugworm onto the 3-3 and just trade off with the Empress seems pretty good. It's just the how to follow up with this. Will he go for the heal, or will he just get Priest of the Feast down?
I would like Priest of the Feast here, and I'm not even sure I would trade. Like, I actually think I would go face.
Oh, really?
I want to finish this game. Like,
yeah, I guess what's a 2-2 actually going to do to you? You're at full health. Your minions are 6 health plus. Like, are you really afraid of a 2-2? Unless Yogg comes down and buffs it. 5 Blessing of Kings onto the 2-2 from Yogg, then you'll cry.
Yeah, that's for sure. Probably give it Winfrey as well.
Yeah, why not? Why not at this point? But no, I don't really mind either way. There's no reason to feel the need to pressure too heavily because, you know, the Druid's back up to a reasonable health total.
Yeah, oh.
There's the second Roots. So that's what, 20 damage? Yep, so
yeah, it
he has 20 burst available from hand. I would not be too upset at double Moonglade here. You put 2 6 drops on the board and heal.
I like it for sure. 1 Moonglade and then you could consider Force of Nature.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, based off what the first Moonglade is, you might alter your plan. But I definitely like at least trying for 1. You have so much power available. Like, why not at this point? You're not in the sort of dire position he was in a few turns ago where it felt like you had to Yogg. To try and come back into the game.
But the thing is, it looked like Gera is considering his best opportunity to win this game is just wait until Hoy is getting out of value. He's drawing a lot of cards.
Shield block.
Oh. The Moonfire. Let's see. Discover a minion.
A casual Ragnaros. Okay. Spellbender's not too bad as well for the removal. Here's some hella overdraw going to happen now as that is a sprint. Now Hoy is under quite a lot of pressure. He does not want to see any more card draw from this Yogg.
Silent.
Not bad. Portal, why not? Okay. Eye for an eye. Oh, and a Silver Moon as well. Oh, the Blizzard is actually huge. Oh, and the Elemental Destruction's even more huge. Oh my
god. And the Yogg actually survived.
Yeah, that's actually kind of nuts. Okay, there's not a world in which you could entomb Yogg. How confident are you feeling? I don't know.
You could actually consider, like, you know that the entomb on the Malgus is really important, but...
Sigar upset with that smite. Did not want Spellbender to be the card there. Also, interesting that you chose... I mean, it's always a tough one, actually, because when you try and remove 2 minions with a Mage Secret down, it could be Effigy. And then you're in trouble. I suppose he did have the Shadow Word Death to follow up with. And entomb. So he did have answers if it was Effigy, but that would be like its whole turn. And now Hoy has, how much is it, 26 from hand now?
Yeah, this is looking really rough for Gera.
How did this happen?
Like, the Yogg is just doing such a good work, and no matter what, even if Gera find a way to survive, there is still a Ragnaros.
Yeah, you can just slam Ragnaros, and Hoy managed to heal up enough and has 2 Moonglade portals that he doesn't have to really worry about fatigue at the moment, at least for the next 2 to 3 turns, because he has so much heal. And he's on 28 anyway. He's nearly on like a full amount of health as it is. So kind of a crazy game so far. And the secret was eye for an eye, correct?
Yeah, eye for an eye.
Doesn't normally matter too much versus Priest. They're not normally bursting you when it's not the combo version at least. But Quirm's going to go down there and just clear up the 1-1. Keep it simple. Clear off the giant as well. But Yogg's still up for 7, and that's just game. Hoi finishes up 3-0 with Mali Druid. And some impressive play overall. It did end up with Yogg pretty much winning that game for him on the back end there. But all the decisions up until that point were pretty decent from Hoi. Seemed like he seemed a little bit pressured at some times when he's letting the rope burn out quite late before he started his turn, but he did manage to close it out 3-0 versus Gaara the Priest. Not enough to get the game towards the end there. And yeah, that's the series overall. What did you think, Lothar?
Well, that's another 3-0 by Druid, right? With the exact same archetype, I would say, even.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. I mean, we were watching, obviously, we cast the Druid versus the Control Warrior game, and a little bit unfortunate for Gaara, to be honest. He drew, like, 0 shield slams, which is some of the key removal cards. Mm-hmm, the reason Control Warrior decks work so well versus Druid is you would just line up your removal perfectly with all the minions they're going to place, and it just wasn't enough because he just didn't get what he needed. So kind of crazy overall, but good job for Hoi, 3-0 in this format. That's pretty impressive.
Yeah, for sure. Like, we can see Druid is a really good deck, and he played it good. Like, he felt confident by playing Druid. So, yeah, looking forward to his game against AKA Wonder, like, to see who continues from this group.
That's going to be the one coming up next. But yeah, we're starting to understand more why Druid's swiftly becoming one of the like top 3 picks as opposed to the top 2 picks we thought were always going to be Shaman or Warrior.
I mean, it looks like the deck has infinite amount of threats in this format. At least it looks like so, right? When he was playing against the Warrior, you said he didn't draw the Shield Slams, but at the same time, I feel like just the Druid, even with the Shield Slams, if that would be present, he still was just ramping up every single time and just putting threats on board, you know?
Yeah. So now we see the replay and highlights of the match, powered by HP, of course, who are sponsoring this tournament, as the guys are playing on the Omen laptops, which are actually pretty insane. But this is game one with a choking casually on stream, so I apologize about that. But yeah, game one was a pretty crazy one as well. The Hunter, I think Gaara was kind of forced into his play style of just going very aggressive because his opening hand was like double quick shot and nothing much else, to be honest. So bit of a rough one for Gaara, I feel. You can see drew the Yashiraj, didn't get it off Barnes, so the grand plan didn't come together for this one.
To be honest, I'm not the biggest fan of this deck. It seems to be very inconsistent. The traps are not getting the value, and you can't really keep them in your hand until you will get your lock and load. So I tried this deck like a lot when the lock and load was released, and nothing changed for me, you know?
Yeah, and we see, hang on, has Maligos closed out every single game in this series? So, I think it did, right?
Yeah,
did Maligos
for sure.
Burn close out every game? Obviously with helping hands from Yogg, for example, but I think that Maligos did actually clear it up every single time there. But we see Hoi a little bit pressured again. You know, it'd be good to ask him about it when he comes here for the interview after this is over, just to see, you know, if he's having any, you know, just issues. It's obviously very hot in here, and he's been playing all day as well, so that starts to take its toll. We see now the Yogg doing Yogg things is how I'm going to describe this, as the buff up for the Arcane Giant teasing Gaara, but then the Deadly Shot coming out to clear the game up here, and this definitely helped Hoi massively in this matchup.
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, we have seen a lot of damage being played by this Yogg just to the face,
Look,
right?
Look at the damage to face. This is how it was made possible.
10 damage from Yogg, cleared the board. Doesn't really matter, right? If you lose the Yogg, you're not really losing that much because you actually played the Power Blast to opponent's face and cleared the opponent's minion.
Yep, kind of crazy overall as Maligos finishes up after Yogg again. And yeah, just this is pretty much the story of the series so far. Yogg getting like, you know, a good amount of work done, or just really just pushing the end of the game, and then just Hoi holding off on Maligos long enough to fill it up, and we see Yogg again.
Yeah,
very difficult to talk about to a certain extent. Well, as we know, everyone's opinions are very one-sided about Yogg itself. So this is a super powerful Yogg. I think this was the most powerful of the series overall.
The Spellbender really made a really huge difference.
Yeah, it
right?
really did just flip the game on its head. And again, Hoi had so many options with the double Moonglade portal as well to continue the game out. Fatigue just didn't even matter at this point. And yeah, Gaara just didn't have the answers he needed to deal with this. And yet again, we see Maligos and the huge burst damage from the spells. They're really going to help close it out.
Yep. It's kind of unfortunate that the Spellmender Like, if look at that. The Elemental Destruction dealt 5 damage to both minions from Gaara, but kept the Yuxaron alive. If even 1 damage more would have been dealt to the Yuxaron, the game would still be going on. Because the Malygos wouldn't be able to finish up the game. So Ragnaros have to be played then. Then Gaara has an answer in form of the Entomb. Maybe he will draw his own... Or maybe, I don't know... Maybe
Entomb into draw the Yug and then play Yug again.
There can be tons of stuff happening, right? But the Yug surviving this and has... and having the protection in form of Spellbender was a huge thing. But we have Hori here.
Hey,
congrats, man.
Thanks.
I mean, it was quite a long match, although it's only a 3-0.
Yeah.
How this happened?
Well, I'm not that used to playing Malygos Druid. I'm more known for playing my Xia Druid. I don't know, like, the Xia put down minion, but I'm a little tired of losing tournaments all the time. Like, I bring Reno Lock and so on. So,
okay.
Like, Six was a Diva, a really, really good deck, and yeah, I have played some in Unleta, but I still think I could have played the series better. There was still some things.
Well, there was the one mistake with the Wild Growth, right?
Yeah, exactly. But that can also not be a mistake if I want to play Yogg without too many spells. But at that point, I thought also was a mistake. Also,
yeah,
it's like my biggest problem with this deck is that I rope too much.
Mm-hmm.
And this deck cycles a lot. Like, because I have to consider if I want a Raven Idol or if I want
Yeah.
Already even a Raven Idol, that's already more decision and noise. So I just have to play it fast and get more.
Yeah, we saw that happen a couple of times. There was one point with the you had Malygos and Living Roots and a Moonfire, and then you could have Gadget Zan, and then you drew the Raven Idol right at the last second.
Exactly.
But we then realized that Moonfire was the last card in your deck,
yeah,
and you had it anyway. So it didn't end up burning you too much, but it did look like you you were not struggling, but like you said, maybe just taking a bit too much time to try and handle that kind of deck at least. But you did it 3-0 though, so you know, not too bad overall.
No, it feels good.
You're definitely
deck.
Putting some work in as well.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, you'll be facing AK Wanderer for your survival again.
Yeah.
This is kind of pretty stressful, right? When you have to play like 2 in a row just to not get kicked out of the tournament. How do you handle those situations?
I was so triggered when I lost to AK Wanderer because we played a Voyeur Mirror.
Mm-hmm.
I played Insert Voyeur and he played Yogg Voyeur. And it's insane the favorite for Insert Voyeur.
Yeah.
But the way I lost was like Yogg into Naturalize, so I started to fatigue more, and then
AK Wanda actually told us earlier he was talking about that match specifically and was like, "Yep, naturalize."
Yeah.
So it just ended the game because he got ahead on fatigue right
early
on. So
that's kind of funny, right? But I
don't Hoy.
I don't want to keep you here on the coach when you still have one more game to play.
Thanks.
It's getting pretty late and it's awfully hot here. So good luck in the last game,
Thank you.
Good luck.
Take a quick break before this final game of which one is it? Group D. So, don't go anywhere. This is PGL Tavern Tales 2.